The future is connectivity.
Connectivity is the apparatus for moving stuff from point A to point B, and there's many kinds of it. For example, roads. You just heard about roads. That's connectivity. It's old Chinese expression. If you want to be rich, first build a road. And my ancestor, blind Jack Metcalfe, built the first 180 roads in Yorkshire to get Yorkshire into the Industrial Revolution. So connectivity, including moving mass, moving energy, moving signals, and signals is mostly what I've been doing. Connectivity, the most important new fact about the human condition is that we are now suddenly connected. And I use the word suddenly referring to October 29th, 1969, when the first internet packets started flying. And since that time, which is yesterday, we've added 5 billion people to the internet, 60-some percent of the population of Earth is now on the internet. So that's the most important new fact. Now, I got involved in connectivity at MIT in 1970. I had just graduated from MIT, and I was given a job to connect MIT to the internet. My boss was J.C.R. Licklider, a particularly well-chosen boss for that task. So I built an IMP interface. I think it was for, an IMP was an interface message processor, a packet switch. I think they gave me number 6. It was on the southeast corner of the 9th floor of 545 Tech Square. And I was given the job as a member of the research staff to connect MIT to this packet switch in the corner, IMP number 6. But then after you get the hardware working, you always have to add some software. And the software we added, I wrote a thing called the Telnet protocol. And the Telnet will allow you to, sitting at your dumb terminal, to log in as if you were a dumb terminal as some other time-shared host across the country. Most of them were PDP-10s. So I built this Telnet, and it was in that, the months that followed, the main purpose of the internet changed. The internet was built because ARPA was tired of buying a PDP-10 for each one of its PIs. So it thought that this Telnet would allow people to log in to other PDP-10s so they wouldn't need their own. So the purpose, the stated purpose in papers was resource sharing, sharing PDP-10s. But now watch what happened. We're able to log into a remote machine. We find that when we get there, our data isn't there. So we can't run programs over there. So we need FTP. We need a file transfer protocol. Okay, let's make a protocol, transfer the files. Oh, I know, some of the files you transfer can have destination addresses in them and content. We could send messages to each other. And in that instant, the purpose of the internet stopped being resource sharing and it started being email. In fact, you could argue email continues to be the killer app. But around 1973, the Xerox Research Center decided to build the world's first PC. And I know there's 20 people in this room who would love to argue that it wasn't the first PC, but the Alto, it was called. And imagine having a building with a PC on every desk. Can you imagine that? Well, that's what we imagined. And then we needed a network to connect all those PCs. And I had just been networking at MIT, and so I was the natural choice, so I lucked out. And so my job was to design a network for the first building full of PCs. And there was lots of competition, by the way. The number one competitor, as usual in connectivity, is SneakerNet. People say, I don't need a network. I'm just going to take my diskette full document on the diskette and wearing sneakers, I'm going to walk over to the printer. I don't need your stinking network. But eventually so we invented Command P. You know, you just go like this, and it saves you a lot of trouble. But there were other competitors, but eventually Ethernet emerged, and it was a combination of three connectivity tools. One was the Gerald Vampire Tap, which you could use to grab hold of a piece of coaxial cable and puncture it without cutting it. So that meant you could install a new PC connected to that coax without bringing the network down. We liked that. So we chose the Gerald tap, and then we chose Manchester encoding for the bits. Each bit cell was half of it was the bit, and the other half was the complement of the bit. And this allowed us to put the clock in the packets, so we didn't have to have a central clock and worry about synchronizing it. And then the third technology was the Aloha network randomized retransmission method. You put a packet on the network. If it gets through, great. If it doesn't get through, randomize and do it again. And so that was Ethernet, the original Ethernet in 1973. I don't know if you've looked around recently, but all three of those technologies are gone. So Ethernet actually wasn't those three technologies. Those were just placeholders. Here's what Ethernet really was. Ethernet brought packets to the desktop. Prior to Ethernet, the packets would stop at the PDP-10, and what you got was a dumb terminal. In preparation for the next major internet transition from dumb terminals to personal computers, Ethernet was a network for personal computers, not for dumb terminals. So it brought packets to the desktop. It ran fast. Because we were on coax, we could run it at, in the end, 2.94 megabits per second was its speed. That's a whole other story. That was 10,000 times faster than what it replaced. So the upgrade was, and not 10%, 10,000 times faster, which made possible later the uploading of cat pictures. And then there was standards. Ethernet joined the trend towards standardization. So TCP, IP, and the protocols of the internet and Ethernet were all standardized. And in the interest of time, the next year is 2019. And 2019 was the 50th anniversary of the internet, 69. And it was also the arrival of COVID-19. It was almost as if we built the internet in anticipation of COVID-19. Because I watched waves of people who swore they would never use video to teach classes. Every professor at the University of Texas, where I was teaching over video almost instantly, and it worked very well. So the internet was there for COVID. In fact, I like using the acronym COVID, which is short for collaborative video. So a reasonable question to ask in the remaining time is, are we done now? Do we have enough bandwidth? And I think the answer, or is there any available, or have we just used all of it? And I use the transistor neuron paradox to answer that question. Transistors are fantastic. They're 2 or 3 nanometers. They switch in picoseconds. And the neurons have been hanging around for 5 billion years, and they're huge, so transistors dominate neurons. But the trouble is, brains dominate computers. That is, we manage to take these superior devices and build inferior machines with them. What do you think the reason for that is? Connectivity, which is the main point I'm trying to make. Connectivity. The neurons have about 10 to the fourth synapses going out of them, whereas your average transistor is barely connected to anything. So that's where we're going to find the more connectivity that we need, is through greater connectivity. Let me mention two of my favorite networks. Connectivity. There are two radios. Oh, how far away do you think the furthest radio is from here? No, the furthest one is 20 billion kilometers from here. And there's two of them. And they just left the solar system, and they're heading out into interstellar space, and they're sending bits back at about 160 bits per second, I think. Plutonium-powered, because there's no sun out there. And guess what encoding they use? They use Manchester encoding on those two radios. The other network that should be of great interest is called GPT. So GPT-3, I heard, I don't know any of this officially, had 175 billion parameters or synapses or connections. And GPT-4 had a trillion, although today, I think it was today, I heard 1.5 trillion. So that's a lot of connectivity in those little nets you all have. But the brain has 10 to the 11th neurons and 10 to the 4th synapses per neuron, so that's 10 to the 15th. Oh, 10 to the 15th is 1,000 times bigger than 10 to the 12th. So I predict that we're going to get better neural nets by adding connectivity, not just fiddling around with the functions. I think I'm done on time. The most significant new fact about the human race is we are now connected, and we need to deal with that. And connectivity should no longer, in the design of our systems, connectivity should not be an add-on. Bob, connect us to the internet. No. Connectivity should be a guiding principle in design, an organizing principle of design. And so let's hear it for connectivity.